How many of you guys remember when someone would ask you if you knew your ABCs? Anybody remember that? Like early on, right? 3 or 4 years old. Do you know your ABCs? And the answer was always yes, right? Even if you didn't really know your ABCs, if you ask any toddler or, you know, young child, do you know your ABCs? And they will say yes. And then they may not know where to start, right? But where do we start? We start with that song, right? A, B, C. We start with that song, and we can kind of pick up on that song. And kids would be very proud in sharing that they knew their ABCs, right? And they'd sing that song, going through the letters. And it's around when we get to that H-I-J-K, things start to fall off, right? Right? After that K, you had that elemento, right? You remember the elemento? What is the elemento, right? Isn't that a car? It sounds like a car, right? Didn't somebody drive like a 65 elemento? Anybody have a car? Yeah, see, that's an elemento right there. If you didn't know what an elemento was, it has like a pickup truck in the back. Oh, can you hear me? Okay.
Sure. Turn it off.
I got it off.
How's this? Ooh. All right. Well, yeah, okay. Now, I was joking. That's really an El Camino. But just the pride in sharing what you knew. And it was a big thing when you were 3 and 4 years old. But if you kind of remember being asked that, it's not something people kept asking you as you grew up. Right? When you were 8 years old, no one came to you and said, "Do you know your ABCs?" Right? No, at least I never experienced that. Anybody experienced that? No, you typically, and if with other children, you don't typically ask after a certain point in time if they know their ABCs, because you're making an assumption. You're making an assumption that they already know their ABCs, that they ought to be further along than ABCs. They ought to be learning something more than ABCs. And the reason they should be learning more than ABCs is because it's a fundamental starting place, right? Understanding letters. Because letters put together in certain combinations form what? They form words. And words in certain combinations, what do they form? Sentences. And then when you put sentences together, they do what? Paragraphs, right? And so what it facilitates is communication. Right? Being able to read, being able to write, being able to communicate. Because the fundamentals of that alphabet, when they go and proceed in maturity and all these combinations, it is that those fundamentals lead to bigger and better things, greater things, right? It is those fundamentals that ultimately lead into greater growth and put people on the moon, put satellites in space, helps us to communicate across the world. And so it's a great thing to know your ABCs, but it's not a good thing if you stay at knowing your ABCs. And the same thing is connected with our knowledge. When we think about our faith, some people are really good about the ABCs of their faith, but they make a decision to stay there. They feel satisfied that I have a basic understanding of my belief system and make no effort to go further. And just like stopping at ABCs, not only do you miss a world of opportunity, a world of blessing, but the world misses blessings because you are still at your ABC level faith. And so today, we're in our series called Grow Up. And today, here's what we want to focus on today. We want to focus on growing our know. I want you to grow your know, all right? And we're still in the same passage we've been in. We're in 2 Peter. And chapter 1, let me get there. And 2 Peter is the second and last letter from the Apostle Peter, written to a church before his death. And it's different holding the mic. Hold on one sec. There we go. And we're going to look at a few verses. We're going to look at verses 3 through 5. He's writing to a church, and in this church, there are these false teachers, false prophets that are coming up, and not just in a church, but across churches. and they're promoting some secret information, and he's wanting to write this letter to correct some things. And so 2 Peter chapter 1, starting at verse 3, says, "His divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence, by which he has granted to us his precious and very great promises, so that through them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped from the corruption that is in the world because of sinful desire. For this very reason, make every effort to supplement your faith with virtue, and virtue with knowledge." Last week we talked about the virtue, that was the goodness, that was that good growth. And now Peter is saying, like, spiritual growth, growing in your walk with Christ, should also see an increase in your knowledge. That you shouldn't be satisfied with wherever you are in your understanding. Now, when we think about knowledge, what type of knowledge? Why do we need to learn more and grow in knowledge? First of all, there are careers that require continuing education, right? Continuing education are classes and coursework that you take after you have maybe gone through some formal education. Maybe you've already received a degree. Maybe you've already received some sort of technical degree and level of understanding or expertise in the field. But certain fields, continuing education can be an option, but in some fields it's required, right? The health profession, it's not an option for you to take extra courses. It's required. For a teacher, you can't say, "Listen, I graduated, I got my bachelor's degree, and I don't ever need to learn anything else about teaching." No, you have to have a certain amount of hours every year in being a better teacher. And when it comes to our faith, if you are a person who says, "I am a follower of Christ," continuing education isn't an option. Whatever it is you think you know and think you understand, you should have a mindset of, "I want to grow in my understanding. I want to grow in my knowledge." And so Peter is telling these Christians, you need to grow in your knowledge. Now, remember, the context of what Peter is speaking to tells us he's not talking about any type of knowledge. Because the idea of growing in your knowledge is something I think would not be controversial in any religion. Right? Even people who aren't religious would think that's a good idea, that you should grow in your knowledge. So is Peter just talking about any type of knowledge? In this day and time, there were groups speaking of a knowledge, and it was a secret knowledge. Greek word is gnosis. It has a silent G at the beginning, G-N-O-S-I-S. And they're saying, really, salvation and coming to know God is this personal knowledge that you need to find and discover. Right? Sounds like something people say today. And Peter's saying, yeah, it's a gnosis. There's a gnosis you need to be growing in, but not just any type of gnosis. Now, here's what we're going to do. We're going to do a little Bible exercise to try to figure out what type of knowledge is Peter talking about. When he talks about growing in knowledge, is he talking about philosophy? Is he talking about cosmology? What is he talking about? And so we're going to understand what Peter was communicating about knowledge by listening to Peter. So we started off in verse 3 of chapter 1. I want you to go to verse 2, same chapter. And here's how he, towards the beginning of his letter, he says, "May grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord." Do y'all see that? So it starts to narrow. He's almost saying in a prayer that I hope you grow in your knowledge, he says, of God and of Jesus our Lord. So now we've narrowed the field. It's not just cosmology. It's not about entertainment. It's not about hobbies. It's not about sports. Now we're talking about God and Jesus our Lord. But maybe it's even narrower than that. Now I want you to move to verse 8, same chapter, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 8. It says, "For if these qualities are yours," he's talking about these steps of spiritual maturity, "if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they keep you from being ineffective or unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ." Even more specific. So within the same chapter, before and after our focal passage, we have the knowledge being focused on Jesus Christ. I want you to go to chapter 2. Chapter 2, verse 20. Same writer, same audience. For if after, and he's speaking of those who are following these false teachers, for if after they have escaped the defilements of the world through the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and overcome, the last state has become worse for them than the first. Y'all see the knowledge is very specific again? The knowledge of what? Our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, maybe he's still talking about a different knowledge, right? Because he's just said it in three places. It was at the beginning, and it was at the middle. Maybe it's something different at the end. Well, let's look at the very end. Chapter 3, verse 18, the very last verse of his letter. But grow in grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and to the day of eternity. Amen. What does he want people to grow in when it comes to knowledge? Knowing Jesus, right? He's talking about growing in your knowledge about Jesus. And the reason I want us to understand this and really, take hold of this, I don't know if, how many of you went to college? Anybody here went to college? Early on, you had to pick a major. Right? You picked something that you thought career path, something that you were interested in. Any of you guys work in a field that's not necessarily the same as your major? Right? You spent all that time, all that effort, sweating all those exams, thinking you were going to go away, but you went another way. I'm the same way. All right? So you say, okay, preacher, you went to seminary. I did go to seminary. That's not where I started. My what I graduated with was a Bachelor of Science in Chemistry, and I minored in math, all right? Now, is it because I love chemistry and math? Really not so. I chose my major. It was originally chemical engineering, and I chose chemical engineering not knowing anything about chemical engineering. I chose it because I saw in a magazine the top earning fields coming out of college. I said, you know what? I want to make as much money as I can make coming out of college. I'm going to choose chemical engineering. And I got into chemical engineering, and chemical engineering did not get into me. And I'm like, I'm going to be here forever if I stay with chemical engineering. And so I changed my major. And I changed my major. You think I went into a major, something I wanted to go to, something I really was interested in? Nope. I looked at how many credits I had. And how could I graduate the quickest? And it was chemistry. Since I had these courses going towards chemical engineering, I had a lot of coursework with chemistry. And as a byproduct, mathematics, right? That's what chemical engineering is, chemistry and math. And math is not something I'm passionate about either. But it gets tagged on as this minor, right? It's just this shows that you have some sort of propensity or enough coursework in this thing. It's not your major thing. It's a side thing. And that's how I graduated, right? And the reason I bring all this up is we kind of come up like that in life. We choose majors, things that we really focus on, things that we think life is about. And sort of the other stuff can fall by the wayside and maybe be a minor. And we have a lot of Christians that major in different things in life and minor in Jesus. And Peter is saying, you ought to change your major. You need to major in Jesus, right? You need to be focused on growing in your knowledge and in your walk with Jesus. Why? Because it makes all the difference, right? I mentioned earlier, I went into chemistry, and I'm not doing anything with chemistry right now, right? Outside of maybe boiling eggs or something everybody does on a day-to-day basis. Some of you had a major, and you studied all of this information, and you're not even doing anything with it. But guess what? Jesus is the only major that you'll always be connected to. Matter of fact, you won't just be connected to it in this life, but in the life to come. And so it encompasses so much of your life. Why wouldn't we major in Jesus? Now, everybody majors in something, right? People are experts in all sorts of just useless stuff, really, right? You know, you got sports fanatics. I'm not a sport fanatic. I'm a fan, but I look here. I can't tell you who's sitting on the bench of the team. But you have people that know the ins and outs of a sport. They know the ins and outs of entertainment and celebrities and so much, all sorts of trivia. They know all this stuff, and they love it. And it's really not going to do you much good in this life. But the author of life, the one who said he is the way, the truth, and the life, that's who we need to know. And so we need to major in Christology. All right? Christology, that's a scholarly word. Y'all know what it means? It's a compound word, okay? Those of you that's been exposed to some education. First word is Christ. The second word is ology. What does ology mean? The study of. And so we need to major in the study of Christ, right? You want to know him not just in a historical way, but to understand his being, his purpose, right? He's not simply a historical figure. A lot of times most people, I think, in our society have some information about Jesus, right? They may not have an in-depth understanding. They know he's a person. There's a religion connected to him. He lived a long time ago somewhere, someplace. He died, and there's a lot of people who've adjusted their life around him, right? And that's just historically, that's just the surface of who he is historically. But we also need to know his person. That, according to the Bible, he wasn't just a man. He was fully God and fully man. And there's a word for that, a scholarly word. It's called the hypostatic union of Christ, okay? And you can just, I don't know, you don't have to memorize that, but it's interesting to know. Even if you don't know the word, the understanding changes everything. That word that I may not remember, hypostatic union, says that he's both fully God and fully man, says something if I understand that when Jesus says something, when he communicates, when he directs, it's not the same as you and I. It's not the same as just being a philosopher or a great leader, an influential speaker. It is saying God spoke this in human history. And if he said it, it must be significant. Right? God doesn't have to say anything. Y'all understand that? He doesn't have to do anything for us. But if he came here and talked about how to live, you think that would be important? Would that be something you'd want to know? Wouldn't you want to know that more than the Texans record? Wouldn't you want to know that more than, I don't know, the lyrics to the latest song? We pick that stuff up and we can sing it and it's fun and it's great. It's not going to change your life. It's not going to help your marriage. It's not going to help raise your children. And so we have this stuff at our fingertips, and we still know more about all sorts of other things. And I want to encourage you, as Peter encourages you, turn your attention to knowing Jesus. Not just information about him, but about who his nature and his direction for our lives, what he says about who we are, what's coming. And it will make all the difference in your life. Now, how do I start to know Jesus, right? What do I do? I want to give you a recipe for growing in your knowledge of Jesus. And let me give you a heads up. If you're new here, those of you who are online, we're going to do some group stuff in a few moments. And it's to help us to just kind of exercise are taking a step in knowing Jesus. How do we know Jesus? What do we do, right? And so I want to give you a little recipe, four steps to growing your knowledge. Here's the first one. It's to pray. Pray. That seems religious. But how does that practically help me to know who Jesus is? Here's what Jesus said about the Holy Spirit. And this is in John chapter 14, verse 26. He says, "But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you." Do you see that? Here's what Jesus says, right? I'm not making this up. Jesus says, the Holy Spirit will help you to know me. He's going to guide you into all truth. And where you would normally forget what I would say, he's going to help you to remember. And so in your prayers, you're asking the Holy Spirit, help me to know Jesus. So it's his recipe for knowing him, part of his recipe for knowing him. But the second thing we want to do, listen, we can't know the living word apart from the written word, right? Because people want to try to make up stuff about Jesus. And it's because they deviate from what is written about Jesus. And so that's when it comes to study the Bible. Now, I didn't put read the Bible. What's the difference? What's the difference between studying and reading? Anybody? Right? There's an intentionality to understand, to get beyond a surface understanding. Because, y'all, I read all sorts of stuff, but I don't study everything. There's not a commitment of time. There's not a desire to seek and get under the layers of something. And that should be our approach to the Word of God. This is God revealing himself to people, to us. And we know more about all sorts of junk than we do about what he has revealed. And so we need to study the Bible, to read, to seek an understanding. Now, studying, I want you to understand there should be an approach to how you study. We've actually already demonstrated. And here's the approach. Know what it meant. Right? A lot of times we try to figure out some sort of interpretation when we read the Bible. First, you want to know what it meant. That means look at the context. Y'all remember earlier when we were trying to understand what type of knowledge Peter was speaking of? Was it just any type of knowledge? Well, we went and looked at the context. We read around the passage to understand what Peter was saying when he used the word knowledge. And we were able to listen to Peter and recognize he's not saying any kind of knowledge. He's talking about the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when it comes to the Bible, you want to use the Bible to understand the Bible. Many times concepts are repeated, and you want to see where they're repeated. It helps you to understand. And so you don't want to start with, go to your imaginations, go to what feels good. You know, I just think God is everywhere. He loves everybody. He's Allah. He's this, he's that. No, let God say who he is. And you go with that. And so when you study the Bible, your approach is to know what it meant, to know what it means. So there's a revelation in historical time to a specific people, right? We got first century Palestine that Jesus is dealing with. We might have a part of Asia Minor that Peter is speaking to, right? 2 centuries ago. And so the language, the cultures is specific to them. But the principle is through every century. And you're looking to understand that timeless principle. And so that's your approach to studying the Word of God. Now, how should I study? One, you should study personally, right? You should spend time on your own. But you should also learn in community. Reason being, he recognized that we needed earthly teachers, right? It talks about in Ephesians that he gave some to be pastors and teachers. He gave them. And so we need people whom he has gifted to help us in our understanding. And so if you're a stay-at-home, all-by-myself Christian, you are limiting your growth. Right, there are plenty of courses that, you know, you got home study, self-study that you can do. But when it comes to the things of God, when it comes to Christology, he says you need somebody else. And so that's why if you're just a virtual, if you're just a YouTube, if you're just I listen to this preacher and that preacher on their podcast, that's a great place to start, but that's not where you need to end. You have to be in community. And so we study the Bible. And then it's not enough to just study the Bible. Guess what? What do you got to do? You got to apply it. Y'all, I went into chemistry. Y'all told you the whole backstory of me going into chemistry, and I did not like chemistry. You know what the worst part about chemistry I didn't like? The lab. I hated lab work. You would be in one class for 5 hours and get one credit. I'm telling you the truth. And dealing with all these chemicals, I messed up so much of my clothing in chemistry. Did not like labs. I was okay with the lecture. It was neat understanding how to balance formulas and, you know, and so on and so forth, how molecular bonds work, and it was neat. That was great. But I didn't really want to do the labs. I wanted to be home. And the reason I bring that up, sometimes Christians are the same way. I like going to Sunday lecture. I enjoy Sunday lecture. But I don't want to do the lab. I don't want to do the lab when my wife is just nagging me. I don't want to do the lab when my husband didn't listen to me. I don't want to do the lab when my kids are annoying me. I don't want to do the lab. That's when you got to do the lab. You got to live it out. It's not just your head knowledge. It is about how you live it out. And so you have to apply it. What does this look like for me? How does this change my thinking? Most applications is a change in your mindset. It's not necessarily something to do. But in a change mindset, you do differently. So if I understand God is sovereign, I worry less. If I understand God is, if he loves me unconditionally, I feel less lonely. Because I feel less lonely, I don't gravitate to things to try to not be lonely. And so it's always a change in mindset, and through the mindset, a change in behavior. And then what do you do after you have prayed and studied the Bible and applied what you understand? What do you think you do after that? Share it would be great. Repeat. Just do it again. Keep doing it. Haddon Robinson told this story of this Chinese student. He was a young boy, and he wanted to learn about jade, right? The stone, the mineral of jade. And he found this expert in jade, and he said, I want to be an expert like you when it comes to knowing jade, of using and shaping jade. Expert said, no problem. We'll start right away. He put a blindfold on the boy. And he put a jade stone in his hand, told him to hold it real tight. And as he was holding it, he was grasping this stone, he started to just talk about stuff. I mean, just general stuff, life, you know, people, the weather. And after several hours, he took the blindfold off, told the young man to go home and come back. Boy came back, same thing, blindfolded him. Put the hand in his, the stone in his hand, and just talked about stuff. And this went on for weeks. And finally, this last time the boy showed up as the teacher's putting his blindfold on him and said, listen, I'm really frustrated. I came here not to talk about all this stuff that you want to talk about. I came here to learn about jade. And the teacher put a stone in his hand. And the boy said, wait a minute, that's not jade. How did he learn? He repeated. He took hold of something, held it, and repeated. And listen, you may not start out as a scholar, but if you spend time, you hold on to what you know about Jesus. You keep coming to Jesus. You keep seeking Jesus. So let's do this. We're going to group up. I need you to group up. Don't get too big. We're going to spend 10 minutes. I know I've gone long. We're going to do about 10 minutes. Go ahead and move now. I'll give you instructions in a minute. Try to be five, no more than five. And online, same thing, want you to interact online. All right. So every group on my left, you're going to be group one. All right? And so that's your passage, Matthew 8, 5 through 13. Same thing with you online. You guys are going to be group one. And everybody on my right, you're going to be group two, John's passage. All right? So you're going to read it, and I want you to answer those two questions. What are three things this passage says about the person and or work of Jesus? And then what difference does any of that make to you? All right? I understand you might not get to the second question. At least get to the first one. All right? Now, one last instruction. Some of you in your circle have way more experience reading the Bible than others. Some of you may even teach these passages. Wonderful. I don't want you to teach it right now. I want you to encourage those around you, right? This is not give a man a fish or give a person a fish. This is teaching people to fish. So I don't need you to take over and go into the Greek and the Hebrew. Understood? Encourage those around you. Guide them with questions to help them understand if you do that. Understand it's okay to get it wrong. We're starting to hold the stone. Y'all got it? All right, go ahead. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right. I know that was short. But it was the sample, okay? That's why we need to come together and learn and encourage one another. I'm hoping this gives you a taste for that you see the blessing in that. All right, so group one, let me see online. Let me check with our online people, those on the online platform. And those of you who watch virtually, sometimes you use YouTube to watch. I encourage you to use the online platform as well, just so you can participate in our worship. And so that first passage, I'm just going to kind of give a general idea of what it is. It is the story of a Roman centurion who had a sick servant who comes to Jesus about his servant. And Jesus is about to go and heal the servant. And, you know, he's like, wait a minute, you don't have to go. I'm a person of authority, and I know that you can basically say it, and he'll be healed. And Jesus was astonished by his faith and healed. So group one online was one of the things that they observed about Jesus, one, that he healed. And also someone indicated that no matter who you are, if you have faith in Jesus, he'll hear. Isn't that a great observation? That he did not dismiss this Gentile, this non-Jew, Roman centurion, who knows what sort of wickedness that he may have done as a military soldier under a pagan understanding of life, but Jesus still healed, listened to his request, and healed the servant. Isn't that something? So let me see. I think they also put an application. Let me see if they put one. He's a healer. He can do anything from anywhere. What he has done for others, he can do for me. He can heal. He hears and he sees. Isn't that beautiful? All right. That didn't come from Pastor Clemens. Came from the same source. Amen. All right, somebody in group one, what was one thing that the passage said about the personal work of Jesus that you guys said that maybe wasn't said with the online group? Anybody? No, something got, yes, on that passage. His authority, that Jesus had some authority, and the centurion recognized Jesus had authority. Isn't that wonderful? Great observation. Another group. Maybe something the other two, you know, something different that you observed in the passage. Are y'all said the same thing? Yes. Jesus acknowledged his faith. He did have some faith, didn't he? Isn't that a great thing? He had some faith. Didn't know the Jewish God per se. At least we don't know that from the context. But he had some faith. Awesome, awesome. One thing. Anybody, out of the things that you discovered, what difference does it make to you? Any group on the left side? You believe. Why do you believe? What about that passage facilitated you believing? Or what? Because of the faith. Okay, so you seeing what Jesus did in response to faith, it encourages you to have faith. Man, can't beat that without a stick. Okay, let's go to the right side, group two. Group two's passage deals with Jesus saying that he is the vine, right? Can't do anything apart from him. And he talks about a purpose so that his joy would be in you. And so somebody on this side, what was something that you observed in the passage about the person and work of Jesus? Stay connected. Isn't that something? The benefit of staying connected, right? We can't do anything apart from him. Anything else, the other two groups? To imitate him. Absolutely. What difference does any of that make? Amen. So, no, you that's not your group. She not lying though. But group two, what difference does that make for you?
Stop it.
Okay, so we got a consensus. We gonna move on. The eyes have it. But unless somebody were to share something personal that they get. We can what? Bear much fruit. We can bear much fruit connected with him. I can bear much fruit connected to him. Think about that. I can bear much fruit. I don't know if you've ever felt like, I don't know if my life is going the way that it's going. You know, the things that I wanted to see in life aren't happening. I just don't feel successful. I connected to him. I can bear. That's what he says. Listen, I just wanted to give us a little exercise. I know I went long. For those of you who want more teaching about how to study the word, I want to refer you to an older sermon. So if you go to YouTube and search the Way of Life Church homework, that was the name of the sermon, and I go into more in-depth tools and techniques in studying the word of God, okay? So that's for you at home, you here. You search YouTube, the Way of Life Church homework, and you should see it. I just want to encourage you guys, don't let it stop here, all right? It will benefit everything in your life. I went to seminary. I graduated, I think, in 2008 from Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary here in Houston. And my degree, it sounds so really preposterous. It's a Master's of Divinity with biblical language. Masters of Divinity, how dare you? Right, that sounds crazy. Like, I just know everything. I have mastered God. Come sit at my feet and I shall open up the secrets of the universe. No. We learn how much we do not know. And it just gave you a hunger to know. But let me tell you, you know, earlier I talked about, you know, the whole chemical engineering thing and going into chemistry. And I worked as a chemist and lab manager. And here I am as a pastor speaking to you about the Word of God. And I want you to understand why. Why did that happen? Were there just these decisions? Absolutely not. I never would have chosen this. Okay? Y'all, I made way more money. Way more money dealing with petrochemicals, working in that field. From my personal perspective, that's what I would have done. But it's because I had a different major. Y'all understand what I mean? I was majoring in Christ before seminary. I was majoring in Christ before college. Very elementary understanding, but I kept wanting to learn, kept wanting to understand, kept wanting to live. Whole lot of failures. But here's the great thing about being in Christ. He's not going to let you stay out there. you know that whole abiding in the vine, you know what I'm saying? And so my whole life has been guided as I sought to walk and to try to live out what I learned. And he led me to what I do now. And he'll do the same for you. I'm not telling you he's going to take you to seminary. But as you major in Christ, it changes everything. Right? You know, there's certain subjects that you can learn in school that have great benefits, but none are as comprehensive as your Christology. Y'all, I learned biology in Jesus. I learned about what life is. I learned about economics in Jesus, right? That's why I don't store my treasure up on earth as much anymore. I learn about sociology in Jesus, about culture and how to make a difference in people's lives. There's so much that I learn in Jesus. So much you will learn in Jesus. You will understand psychology of how your mind should process, how you should be as a husband and a wife, how you should raise your children, what goals should you be promoting in their lives that will make a difference, not just for them, but for this planet. And it starts with a mindset that says, you know what, let me just come to know who Jesus is. So I want to encourage you beyond this place, if you're watching online, grow your know. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for this day. I thank you for the blessing of your word, God. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for being our teacher, of turning the Bible into a pop-up book, right? Where the life just comes out of the pages. Lord, I thank you for giving us community to learn, to encourage how truth came from circles with people who don't normally necessarily even come together, but your truth came out of that, Lord. And we miss out on so much truth because we're not being intentional in seeking to know. And I pray that we will be intentional, that we'll change our major today. I'm praying for the soul that is in the sound of my voice that has yet to choose Jesus to be their Lord and Savior, that that be the first thing that they know, that he lived for them, that he loved them, that he died for them, and he rose for them. And if they believe that he died for their sins, if they believe that he is their Lord and would follow him with the rest of their lives, then one day will he not only have risen for them, he's going to come back for them. And so if you're in the sound of my voice and you've never made that decision, I pray you do it right now. And that you just keep on saying yes to Jesus. God, I thank you. Bless your people. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Listen, if you need help, if you want to connect with God, we invite you to connect 832-905-9046. You can also do so on the website, thewayoflifechurch.com/connect. If it's knowing Jesus, you need some help with that. If it's committing to Jesus, if it's being baptized, you don't even know what that is. We will help you. And it is our joy and pleasure to do so. Well, listen, thank you guys for being patient. Again, I hope this just kind of whets your appetite. And that it's something that you'll want to do over and over again. It'll make every difference in your life. Heavenly Father, I thank you again for the blessing of this day. Bless your people as we leave this place. Never leave your presence. One day, God, we'll be able to thank you face to face. But in the meantime, bless us to come together. To celebrate you and to learn from you all over again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a wonderful day, Lord.